morning, Samantha brought Lydia to meet Nellie in the tunnel. But when she saw how Nellie's eyes glowed and how gently she touched Lydia's dress, Samantha wondered if she had been wrong to bring the dog. Nellie had never owned a dog, not even a simple doll, and certainly not a doll as beautiful as Lydia. "It's all right if you play with her," Samantha said. "Look, her hat can come off, and her dress even has little buttons." While Nellie cradled Lydia, Samantha told her what had happened. "Jesse left, and nobody will tell me why," Samantha said. Nellie didn't answer. She was buttoning the tiny buttons. "I think I know, though," Samantha continued. "I think she's going to be an actress." Nellie carefully removed Lydia's hat and turned it over in her hand. "She'll be famous," Samantha went on. "And one day she'll come back here and we'll go to see her. And she'll take you and me to meet all the actors and actresses. Only you and me out of the whole town, because we were her friends." Nellie still had nothing to say. Now she was looking at the doll's tiny leather shoes. In the days that followed, Samantha came up with several reasons for Jesse's leaving. Maybe Jesse had gone to New Orleans with Lincoln to be a singer there. Jesse had a beautiful voice. Or the president might have asked her to be a spy in Europe. She'd sew elegant clothes for kings and queens and learn their secrets. Or maybe her brother had been kidnapped and taken to South America, and Jesse was going to rescue him. Then one day, Nellie had a suggestion. "Maybe she's got a baby," Nellie said. Samantha was startled. "Why'd she do that?" Nellie shrugged. "Lots of people do. They just like babies," she said. Samantha had to agree. Jesse loves babies. "Well then?" Samantha was annoyed. Nellie's idea wasn't half as exciting as any of hers, but it was too sensible to be ignored. "Why wouldn't Cranberry tell me if it was a baby?" asked Samantha. Nellie shrugged again. "Grown-ups don't like to talk about babies, honey." Samantha had to agree. "I asked Grandmary about babies once, and she said it wasn't a proper subject for young girls." Nellie nodded in understanding. "I asked Mrs. Hawkins, and she said the stork brings babies, but she wouldn't talk about it anymore," Samantha continued. "I don't think it's true anyway," said Nellie. "When my baby sister came, the midwife was at our building. My other sister and I had to go out with my uncle. When we got back, my baby sister was there, and the midwife was fixing tea for my mother. But there wasn't any stork anywhere." Samantha was puzzled. "What's a midwife?" she asked. "She's a lady who visits whenever a new baby comes," Nellie answered. "My uncle said she brings the baby in her little black bag. But I looked in, and the bag was full of things like doctors have. There wouldn't be any room for a baby in there." "Nellie, we've just got to find out what happened to Jesse," said Samantha. "If we just knew where she lived, we could ask Lincoln. He must know where she is." "I know where she lives," said Nellie. Samantha's eyes were wide with surprise. "You do?" Nellie nodded. "A woman across the street from Jesse makes an herb tea that cures headaches. One day, Mrs. Ryland wanted some, so she sent me home with Jesse to get it. I can show you." Samantha hugged her. "Oh, Nellie, that's perfect. Only we can't go in the daytime. They'd stop us for sure. We'll go tonight. When everyone's in bed, I'll sneak down the back stairs and meet you right here in the tunnel. Look out your window and watch my house. Grandmary always turns out the gas lamps just before she goes to bed. That's how you'll know it's all right for me to come down and meet you." Nellie agreed. She knew that no one at the Ryland house would even notice if she went out after she had finished her evening chores. the nighttime was very quiet. But that night, noises seemed to come from everywhere. The crickets were making a terrible racket. The bushes and trees rustled as though they were hiding wild animals, and dogs barked all around. Samantha closed the back door carefully and hurried to the tunnel to find Nellie. The two girls held hands and started out of the yard and up the street. As long as they were on familiar streets, where gas lamps glowed with a friendly light, they thought their adventure was grand and very exciting. But after they crossed the railroad tracks, the streets got dark and narrow. The houses were dark too, and very small. Somewhere there was loud music and noisy laughter, and once in a while there was shouting. Nellie squeezed Samantha's hand so tightly that Samantha couldn't have let go if she wanted to, but she certainly didn't want to. She was just as frightened as her friend was. Maybe we shouldn't have come at all, she thought, but she didn't say that to Nellie. She wanted to be brave. Are you sure you know the way? Samantha whispered. I think so. Nellie's voice was shaky. It's not much farther now. Samantha looked at the drab houses they were passing. Even in the dark, she could tell there wasn't much grass in front, and there was very little room for flowers. Why does Jesse live here? She asked. This is the colored part of town, Nellie answered. You mean Jesse has to live here? Samantha asked. Nellie looked at her. Samantha was smart about so many things that Nellie was always surprised at what her friend didn't know. Yes, of course, Nellie said. Why? Asked Samantha. I don't know, Nellie said. It's just the way grown-ups do things. Nellie, will you have to work in the factory again? You'll get sick if you go back. And what will I do without you? Nellie had started to cry. It'll be all right, Samantha. Really, it will. Only I'll miss you so much. Samantha couldn't stand to see Nellie crying. Wait a minute. I'll be right back, she said. She dashed across the yard and into her own kitchen. Mrs. Hawkins, Samantha cried breathlessly. Mrs. Hawkins, they're sending Nellie away, and her family doesn't have enough food. We have to give them something. Mrs. Hawkins would have been quick to help even without Samantha's begging. In a few minutes, she had packed a basket with a pie and fruit, some food in tin cans, and a ham. Samantha ran back to the Rylands' kitchen carrying the basket. And something else. She put the basket at Nellie's feet. Then she placed Lydia in her arms. Here, Nellie, you take Lydia, Samantha said. She'll be your friend. Samantha hugged Nellie and stayed with her until the Rylands driver came. Later that afternoon, Uncle Gard and Cornelia were having tea with Grandmary. Samantha was there too, but she was not playing and laughing with Uncle Gard. She was sitting in her chair, working on her sampler, because even that was better than talking to grown-ups. Samantha was feeling very angry with grown-ups. Grown-ups took her friends away and never even told her why. So she sat and stabbed the needle at her sampler, and everyone wondered why Samantha was in such a bad mood. Then suddenly, even before she knew she was going to, Samantha blurted out, I know why Jesse left. Grandmary looked surprised. You do? Yes, she has a baby, Samantha said. Now Grandmary was really surprised. How do you know that? She asked. Nellie and I went to her house at night, and we saw. Samantha was sure Grandmary would punish her now. But Grandmary looked more troubled than angry. You were very wrong to do that, Samantha, she said. Well, you were very wrong not to tell me, Samantha answered. She was not feeling very respectful. Grandmary took in her breath sharply. She looked at Uncle Gard and Cornelia for help, but they said nothing. Granary put her teacup down and nodded slowly. Yes, Samantha, I think you are right. I should have told you, she said. The room was very quiet. Samantha felt pleased and relieved. Well, can Jesse come back? She asked. Now, Samantha, you know she has to take care of the baby. But she could bring him with her, said Samantha. He wouldn't bother anybody. Grandmary looked thoughtful. Well, I hadn't thought about that. But I suppose if Jesse wants to, and Mrs. Hawkins doesn't object. As if anyone could possibly imagine Mrs. Hawkins objecting to Nathaniel. Hawkins told me. Grandmary stopped short. She looked at Uncle Gar, and then she looked at Samantha. Then she nodded slowly. Yes, she said. Yes, I think Samantha's sense of value is just fine indeed. Samantha ran to her grandmother. Grandmary, we've got to help Nellie's family. They don't have enough food, and they don't have enough coal. Can we help them, please? Grandmary's eyebrows went up, and then she threw back her head and laughed. Yes, Samantha, yes! I guess if you care enough to give up your finest treasure, then we can find a way to help Nellie's family. She gave Samantha a proud smile. You really are quite a fine young lady, Samantha Parkington, she said, as she opened her arms to fold Samantha in a hug as warm as summer sunshine.